We had a dream. We had an awesome dream.
There were four California girls who dreamed of being the Beatles.
We had the absolute goal to become, you know, the female Fab Four, or at least Simon and Garfunkel.
We were these sunny California girls who did 60s garage pop.
I just wanted to get out there and play music.
The Bangles were an all-girl, all-American garage band with a unique chemistry on stage and off.
Everybody writing, everybody singing, everybody playing, and everyone harmonizing. If you knew what you
are, it was meant to be, you know?
They were all for one and one for all until one of them became a star. It's just another manic
Monday. All of a sudden now, it wasn't just a band thing, it was Susanna Hoffs and the Bangles.
I suddenly became the lead singer. And, you know, how do I deal with that? Wish you were
Sunday. The Bangles earned a place at the top of the charts. But they were no longer on top of their own music. Walk like
an Egyptian. It was just frustrating because you feel this complete loss of control. I started losing a sense of who I was.
It was just very painful.
All of a sudden, no one's sympathetic. I'm sorry, you're rich. You're famous.
The band's inability to confront their problems and confront each other destroyed them.
It wasn't a happy all-girl family, that's for sure.
True or false, you all secretly want to kill each other. Whoa! Oh.
Now, four friends who found fame but lost each other along the way. The Bangles, behind the music. At a time when rock bands were still strictly a boys' club, the Bangles proved that women musicians could carry a guitar as well as a tune. The Bangles' Sunny California sound sold over 10 million records, and they became the first all-girl band to have five top 10 hits. Walk like an Egyptian. But after a determined 8-year climb from garage band to number one hitmakers, jealousy and frustration destroyed the Bangles in 1989. It would be over a decade before the four former friends would play together again. In the spring of 2000, the Bangles began work on their first album since 1988. After a dozen years apart, they were able to recapture the harmony they'd shared in and out of the studio. Now you got yourself so wrapped up in it. All you gotta do is wait a minute.
All you gotta do is ride the ride. This is all fresh again. This is all fresh. You know, we've had time away from each other, so this is a whole new fresh beginning.
I think we've just learned how to be better musicians, better friends, better collaborators, because in the years that we weren't working together, we just kind of grew up a lot and learned how to communicate. Never look into me in the eye.
There's still bumps in the road, but now you feel like maybe you have some tools to deal with it, you know?
They're so light that you just put pressure on them and they barely touch.
We've kind of gone back to that simple place where we would like to have the feeling of control, if you can.
Or not.
The simple place where the Bangles started was the Peterson family's garage in California's sun-blasted San Fernando Valley. While other girls wanted to date rock stars, sisters Vicky and Debbie wanted to be rock stars.
I had an electric guitar when I was 9 years old. How cool is that?
I'm sure that the neighbors' ears were offended more than once.
In 1976, 17-year-old Vicky had a rocking garage band. Determined to join the fun, 15-year-old Debbie borrowed a drum kit and auditioned with Heatwave.
It was instant. It was absolutely instant. I'm like, she's in. She's in, all right?
I love that. It was crazy.
She's in. She's in.
The girls had a single ambition, to rock as hard as boys did.
Actually, at the time, it was pretty ridiculous to think that you could have a functioning band of four women be successful.
I just wanted to get out there and play music.
Across town in an upscale L.A. neighborhood, Susanna Hoffs had grown up surrounded by music.
My mom would listen to Top 40 radio, which in the 60s was incredible.
The Beatles were my absolute gods.
And we would get these early copies of the records and just listen to them until we wore the vinyl out.
As she played and replayed her mom's Beatles albums, 21-year-old Susanna imagined playing guitar and singing in a band.
I had these kind of what I think of now as these kind of imaginary fantasy bands. You know, I never did a show. There was never a gig. There was never a performance.
It took a tragedy to jolt Susanna into making her fantasy a reality. On December 8th, 1980, came news that forever changed Susanna's life.
We believe it's John Lennon who was shot at tentative identification.
John Lennon was brought to the emergency room shortly before 11 p.m. He was dead on arrival.
It was just unbelievable, you know, and I think it sort of made me feel like, you know, you just have to do that thing that you want to do. You can't wait.
Shortly after Lennon's murder, Susanna picked up the phone to answer an ad for a female guitarist. Vicki Peterson took the call.
80% of our first conversation was about John Lennon and what he meant to us, what the Beatles had meant to us.
It became this incredible bond with this strange person that I'd never met.
I think for us, it kicked us in the butt. You know, it made us just think, you know what? Any minute we could go, we're gone. Let's make this happen now.
A few weeks later, the Peterson sisters went to Susanna's house to jam. Immediately, the three girls laid the foundations of a deep friendship.
Being in this band, especially, was like a marriage. That was the first date.
It was sort of like getting married to someone you met an hour before.
Debbie and I left that night and said, I think we have a new band.
The three girls recruited bass player Annette Zelinskis and called themselves the Bangs. Soon they were banging it out in small clubs.
It was amazing to realize that your very beautiful and very protected daughter was going to be going down to some neighborhood that probably we had never even driven through.
Little tiny clubs. One occasion I remember, there were probably five of us there with the bartender.
That was a New Year's Eve, wasn't it?
The Bangs saved up, recorded a single, and set out to get it played by popular FM DJ Rodney Bingenheimer.
I guess Susanna figured I have to get this to Rodney somehow, and she did.
Saying that I'd come to the Odyssey where he was a DJ on Monday nights and I'd wear a miniskirt and, you know, I'd give it to him personally.
She looked so stunning. Susanna is definitely the rock and roll Audrey Hepburn. And so she shows up, I go, wow. And then she hands me the single. I took it home, and wow, it was like an 80s Mamas and Papas.
In the summer of 81, Rodney Bingenheimer played their record and spun the Bangs into a different league.
He played it, and we just screamed and like hugged each other. We're jumping up and down. It was like one of those most exciting moments ever.
And our audience just doubled, tripled, quadrupled after that.
The Bangs' growing success caught the attention of a powerful music industry insider, manager Miles Copeland.
It was the vibe of it. It was the excitement. It was the stupidity of it, in a sense, that made it engaging.
And Susanna looked at me and went, who's Miles Copeland? And I said, you know, oh, IRS, you know, he manages this police and whatever.
Miles invited the Bangs to his office, but their excitement was tempered by the fact that Miles was already managing another successful all-girl band, the Go-Go's.
Any artist always looks over his shoulder and sees what somebody else is doing. They want to be taken in their own right. They don't want to be a copy of something else.
I was immediately defensive and, you know, I was like, well, we're not some poor man's Go-Go's. I actually brought a tape recorder to that first meeting. Set it on the desk. Turned it on. I don't even think there was a tape in it. I think we just brought the tape player just for the effect, you know?
Despite their reservations, the Bangs signed with Miles Copeland in the spring of 82. Miles had them record 5 songs. But just before the album's release, a New Jersey band with the same name threatened to sue the Bangs. They needed a new name fast.
When we were the Bangs, we loved the Bangs because it was very powerful, very short and in your face.
We're bouncing around ideas and we thought, well, let's just add 3 letters, and it's kind of a Beatles reference in some odd way. Bangles, Beatles.
The Bangs' garage years were over. The Bangles' rise to the top was just beginning. Coming up, the Bangles survived their first tour.
The audience was definitely not the ideal audience for us. They're in their leather jackets and they're like this.
And later, a famous fan shows his admiration by giving the Bangles their first big hit. Just another manic
Monday. The whole Prince thing was kind of bizarre because he had a thing for Susanna.
It always felt a little uncomfortable.
When Behind the Music continues.
Your name and instrument?
Susanna, rhythm, guitar, and vocals.
Debbie, drums and vocals.
Annette, bass, guitar.
Vicky, lead guitar.
In 1982, 2 years after musical soulmate Susanna Hoffs and sisters Vicky and Debbie Peterson bonded in a Los Angeles garage, the Bangles set off on their first American tour.
I got Sunshine from California coming on stage right now, ladies and gentlemen.
You're the Bangles.
We're there. Quit day jobs. This is it. We're on the road. This is what we've been waiting for. We are on tour in America. How brilliant is this?
1, 2, 3, 4.
Opening for the ska band The English Beat was a baptism of fire.
It was really tough. And the English Beat crowd was brutal. Brutal.
They're in their leather jackets and they're like this. At you for 45 minutes while you're on stage, spitting at you.
We came out and someone threw a milk carton right at my head, you know, right when I was singing a song, and like cut me in the head.
I was back in the bathroom or the dressing room, you know, cutting gum out of Susanna's hair because somebody had thrown gum on stage.
It's literally like vaudeville and people throwing tomatoes at you.
And we called it character building at the time.
Battered but unbowed, the Bangles returned from the tour and got their next big break. Columbia Records wanted to sign them.
We really felt like we were moving up. You know, slowly but surely we're just going upward.
But just prior to signing, bass player Annette quit to join her boyfriend's band.
These things happen. You know, it's just happened to the Beatles. Sometimes when a group begins to get going, one member doesn't quite fit, and, you know, those changes happen.
The hunt was on for a new Bangle before the record company could get cold feet.
It did scare me because I'm extremely aware of how chemistry can make a band good or incredible.
As luck would have it, a talented bass player was already looking for her chance to join the Bangles.
It was one of the few times in my life that I did a totally calculated thing and said, I really like this band.
27-year-old Michael Steele was a veteran of the LA music scene. She had started out 9 years earlier in another all-girl band, The Runaways.
I mean, it's kind of funny. I mean, after the whole Runaways experience, I was like, I will never do a girl band again. Ever. You know, so I'll never say never.
Michael's bass playing solidified the Bangles sound.
She was perfect. She was perfect.
When they signed with Columbia in the fall of 83, the Bangles knew they'd finally hit the big time.
That was so amazing to me because Columbia was like Dylan and the Byrds were on that label, you know?
It was the thrill of, okay, the door's there and we're actually being asked to come in and now we're in the party, okay?
It was scary, you know, just thinking we were going to be such a part of such a big machine.
We had always been kind of a self-contained unit, and then all of a sudden there were these kind of guys in suits, you know, listening to us and looking at us, you know?
Now this is serious. This is serious now.
The Bangles released their first album, All Over the Place, in the spring of 84. With a new lineup and a new single, Columbia stylists helped the band find a new look. Wasn't it me who said
there'd be a price to pay and I won't feel bad at all? Oh, how did I put on the high heels with the bobby sock lace things in the If the Hero Takes a Fall video? What were we doing? We're wearing like 1,000 pounds of junk jewelry, but at the time it felt like we were had a look, you know, but it just wasn't really our look.
Then the Bangles caught the eye of a powerful new fan, 80s megastar Prince. Oh no, let's go crazy. As a token of his admiration, Prince gave the Bangles a song for their second album. And when Manic Monday hit the airwaves in the spring of 86, it soared up the charts to number 2.
Once the Manic Monday phenomenon began, and CBS Records made them the number 1 priority at the label, things really started happening fast. Tell me in his bedroom voice,
"Come on, honey, let's go make some noise." In the wake of Manic Monday's success came rumors of a romance between Prince and Susanna.
There was never anything romantic between us, you know. It was just this sort of awkward relationship.
We are now getting attention not for our music or for our accomplishments or for our endurance, but because Prince has a crush on Susanna.
You know, the Prince Sue thing was a big deal. There were tons of rumors around, and you know, to be honest with it, we didn't really do much to quell the rumors. They were great for the band.
The Bangles caught a massive wave of success and were loving the ride.
That's what you want when you start it off, doing this whole thing. You want gold record, you want number one, you know. It's exciting.
A long dream that comes true.
Yeah, it's another milestone for us.
But fame was a double-edged sword. Rather than focus on the four friends as equals, the press singled out Susanna for stardom.
I think Susanna at the time was like, you know, the little sex kitten. I love it in your room at night. You're the only one that gets through to me. And I personally wanted the Bangles to be seen more as musicians and as a band, not just little sex poodles up there, you know.
All of a sudden now it was Susanna Hoffs and the Bangles.
I suddenly became the lead singer. And, you know, how do I deal with that?
Susanna's emerging stardom was the first crack in the Bangles' friendship. The stage was set for a bigger break to come. Coming up, the number one hit that divided the band. Walk like an
Egyptian. I didn't sing on it, I didn't play on it. It was a drum machine, you know.
It felt like a slap in the face.
And later, the band makes a critical decision.
We'll now have a moment of silence where we review the biggest mistake the Bangles ever made.
When Behind the Music continues. ...1986 was a manic year for the Bangles. The Prince pen Manic Monday brought the band a number 2 hit and the attention of the press. The year would end with an even bigger triumph, their first number 1. Walk Like an Egyptian. Walk Like an Egyptian held the number 1 slot for 4 weeks. Despite their dream come true, the Bangles were miserable.
The god of irony was laughing down upon us. You know, you're gonna have a huge record, but it's gonna be the record that you feel the most estranged from as an artist.
Yes, ironically, it's the signature song. It's the song everybody always talks to me. My friends are like, oh, Walk Like an Egyptian. I'm like, oh, God, please, you know, because it's just, unfortunately, had a lot of bad memories for me.
The record was a hit, but making it had been a demoralizing process for the Bangles. They say that producer David Kahn's approach to recording the song divided the band.
The nasty part of that was when we were forced to audition for verses, basically. He had us one by one go out to the mic and sing, you know, a selected verse.
David had one of those minds where he could only see it one way, his way.
He'd be in the control room holding the little button, the talkback button, going, do it again, you know, with this complete depressed, it just made you feel like piece of, I can't say it, just made you feel terrible, like this big, you know.
He didn't like the way Debbie sang any of the verses. So, and there were only three anyway, so he just sort of knocked her out of the competition.
Debbie was originally supposed to sing the lead. Ultimately, she didn't even sing a verse. The negative studio experience further eroded the creative bond between the four friends.
I wasn't feeling a lot of support from the other band members at the time, as far as like my drumming, because they weren't coming in and saying, well, hang on a minute, you know, why are you picking on her so much, you know?
We're as responsible as anybody for that, I think, because we didn't recognize it and call it and say, hey, this is bullshit.
It's just like any relationship. You know, you have to learn to fight. You have to learn how to fight. And you have to learn how to say those things that are hard to say.
I mean, we didn't fight like we should have. We didn't fight like all boy bands fight.
Unity within the band continued to deteriorate as Susanna Starr rose to new heights.
Susanna was getting most of the attention, plus the fact all the singles that were released featured her voice, and so that didn't sit well with the rest of the band.
They wanted it to be four people, absolutely. All the photos had to be all four, there had to be four spotlights. It was almost an oppressive rule.
At a certain point, it is out of your hands. I mean, you just can't change what someone's gonna write about you.
In early 88, the Bangles went back into the studio to record a song for the Less Than Zero movie soundtrack. Hazy Shade of Winter shot to number two in April of 88. It was the first time the Bangles made a hit record on their own terms. Hang on to
your hopes, my friend. It was a moment where we actually sounded the most on a record the way we actually sound live.
If we were left alone in a recording studio, we were okay, and we could function, and we could actually do a pretty good job.
I mean, if we hadn't been so messed up as a band, you know, perhaps that could have been a turning point, you know? Look around.
With renewed confidence, the Bangles chose a new producer for their third album, David Sigerson.
I really needed to see if they were a band or not to know whether I'd be comfortable working with them. And I saw that they were a band, but they were a very oddly uncomfortable band.
David was great as far as making all of us feel special in what we do and being very positive, and we needed that.
I think that they had all sorts of painful and divisive experiences. And they had a core of friendship, which they treasured, and I think we're looking for a way to get back to. And I think that I maybe represented a way that they felt that could happen.
But David's positive approach could not heal the rift between the Bangles. Tensions within the group had grown intolerable.
Close your eyes, give me your hand.
In early 89, Eternal Flame became their second number one hit. But it came too late to recapture the once sunny spirit of the Bangles.
It was like a marriage where everybody became estranged. It was a cold environment.
Co-written by Susanna, Eternal Flame was not a hit with everyone in the group.
I was feeling emotionally divorced from a lot of the music that was going on. Eternal Flame is a beautiful song. Whitney Houston could have a hit with it. Why are we doing it?
Just frustrating because you feel this complete loss of control about something that you love so much.
Am I only dreaming, or is this burning an eternal flame?
As the bonds between them unraveled, the Bangles did agree on one thing. They had grown unhappy with their manager.
We just felt like Miles Copeland was not there enough for us.
Well, we really needed him. He was in Africa with Sting.
Instead of looking at ourselves and trying to figure out how to communicate better with each other, I think we started to go on this quest to sort of solve the problem by changing the management.
After a six-year relationship, which took them from the Sunset Strip to stardom, the Bangles and Miles Copeland agreed to part company.
You can't advise people who are dedicated to self-destruct because they don't appreciate that you can self-destruct. It's human nature. You knew they made a mistake, they'll pay the price for it.
We'll now have a moment of silence where we review the biggest mistake the Bangles ever made.
The Bangles signed with another management company, but the change was not the miracle cure the band had hoped for.
It was a disaster. They were interested in Sue as a solo artist.
And that was something they very much wanted or thought I should do. And so I was already kind of like excited maybe in my mind that there would be another life where I didn't have to feel like I was in this kind of cauldron of anxiety.
Finally, Debbie confronted Susanna.
Just, you know, it's like saying, are you still into doing this? Are you still into, you know, this band? And she said to me, oh no, I'm very much into this and blah, blah, blah. You know, she was very, you know, positive about it, but I didn't feel at that time like she was telling me the truth.
Then Debbie reached out to Vicky about the critical condition of the band.
I have been dubbed the Queen of Denial, but I think I was so determined to keep this thing going.
Because she just wanted to keep it together so bad that she wasn't seeing how the rifts that were being formed.
As relationships between the band members broke down, Debbie formed a bond outside the Bangles when she fell in love with road manager Steve Botting.
I proposed to Debbie, asked her father, and did all the, you know, the thing you should do, the way I was taught in England anyway.
It was a very good distraction because it was such a positive thing.
In a quiet English village on June 10th, 1989, Debbie and Steve walked down the aisle.
We were blessed by having an absolutely wonderful day. In England, that doesn't come too often.
I'm seeing the bunny rabbits, you know, across on the lawn of the castle. It's just so cool.
But a cloud hovered over Debbie's otherwise perfect day. Two old friends were not there to share her joy. Neither Susanna nor Michael came to Debbie's wedding.
I just suddenly started having this little nervous breakdown and crying and stuff, and it's like, I have to go home now.
At that point, I just wanted to be home so badly that I just didn't end up going to the wedding.
We had a great time. It was a great wedding. But it made us feel like they don't care.
Even the self-proclaimed Queen of Denial could not ignore the warning signs any longer.
I think the fact that Susanna and Mickey did not attend Debbie's wedding should have been a wake-up call to me. And I think in a way, it was. It was.
Coming up, the Bangles' final confrontation.
I called her up and I said, Sue, I can't do this anymore right now.
This is a divorce, it's not a separation.
And later, turbulent times after the Bangles.
The solo career was much harder than I ever thought it would be.
When Behind the Music continues.
This song is called September Girls.
In the summer of 89, the estranged Bangles were back together on stage. The band harmonized in concert, but just 2 weeks earlier, Susanna Hoffs and Michael Steele had been no-shows at Debbie Peterson's wedding.
I've been crying all the time.
Q Communication within the Bangles had broken down completely.
Vicky got in my face and said, "What's wrong? We gotta talk about it." And I said, "I don't wanna talk about it." And she said, "You never wanna talk about it."
This was my baby. This was the band, you know, that I had started. And now it was sort of disappearing. And I could not change that. It was a really horrible, helpless, devastating feeling.
I just think that everybody was not connecting. I just sort of felt like we were kind of all going through the motions at that point. Reno, checking out the casino, feeling so mean. Oh,
sometimes I wish I could crash and burn. On September 2nd, 1989, the drained and exhausted girls played a concert in Santa Clara, California. It would be the last time the Bangles would perform together.
We would have torn each other to pieces if we would have gone on that tour, you know.
I just felt like physically and emotionally it wasn't really healthy to be walking around with kind of a knot in my stomach and a Pepto-Bismol in my pocket.
All the girls were miserable all the time. Debbie was miserable all the time. It just came to a head. It's just, okay, it's time to move on.
It was just like, I can't do this anymore. It's not fun.
Vicky, however, was still optimistic the Bangles could survive.
I was also the one who, to the LA Times and anyone else who asked, was the one who kept saying, "Oh no, it's really just a hiatus. We'll be back. We will."
But Susanna had different ideas.
I just wanted to get as far away from the source of the stress and tension and anxiety as I could. So I thought, okay, maybe as a solo artist, I won't have to feel so bad.
Michael also wanted out.
I said, "Sue, I can't do this anymore right now." You know, and that was all the managers needed.
In September of 89, the Bangles were called to a meeting with their manager
to discuss what I thought was ticket sales in Australia. When I walked in, I had this strange feeling, like, it's like something was gonna happen, this sort of ominous feeling. I didn't know what.
Me and Sue kind of sat on one side of the room, and Vicky and Debbie sat on the other side on these sort of sofas facing each other.
Then Susanna dropped the bomb.
Susanna said, "I don't think I can make another record with the Bangles." And that was it.
I felt really bad because I think of all the four of us, I was the one who was the most, you know, eager to just move on.
I remember Vicky and Debbie being like totally shocked by it, like they didn't even see it coming.
It was as if your spouse invites you to dinner and you show up at the restaurant. You thought it was going to be an intimate dinner, and you find out that he has brought you to this public place to tell you that he no longer wants to be married to you. There's no discussion, there's nothing about it, it's just, this is over.
And I just looked at it like, we're all moving on. You know, this is a divorce, it's not a separation.
I wasn't quite sure who I was now. So what does this make me now? Oh, this is now I'm ex-Bangle Vicki Peterson?
I didn't even talk to Vicky for weeks after that, because it's like I couldn't talk to anyone. I didn't want to have anything to do with music after that.
Couldn't believe it. Could not believe it. They, at that point, on top of the world, why?
Just 6 months after Eternal Flame had blazed up the charts, the Bangles' fire was extinguished. As a band, the four friends had faced everything together. Now they would face personal hardships alone. In June of 1990, Vicky's fiancé, Bobby, was diagnosed with leukemia.
Bobby was this incredible, fun-loving, you know, he was just so full of life. It's like so out of nowhere.
It's a very sad story. She went back with him to the University of Pennsylvania Medical Center and stayed with him the whole time.
Yeah, she stayed right in the hospital with him to nurse him, be an assistant to the nurses that were there.
Bobby died the following year. He was just 36 years old.
That was very hard. Vicky's been through a lot.
Vicky found solace and strength in a new town and a new band. She moved to New Orleans and joined the Continental Drifters.
Feeling unbound, the heart and breast, got the visor down. I'm headed west a little. Why from now I'm only impressed by the secret you and I confess.
It was such a warm, welcoming environment for me. It was so antithetical to what the Bangles had become that I fell right in and said, this is where I want to stay for a while.
Back in L.A., Susanna focused her energy on her solo career. In March of 91, she released the album, When You're a Boy.
I've been dreaming since I was born. In my dreams, I see eyes like yours.
But Susanna's album stalled at a disappointing 83 on the charts.
Unfortunately, she made a classic mistake. She just went and hired a bunch of session guys and did some, you know, something that was expected and just failed.
The solo career was much harder than I ever thought it would be. There were so many jobs to do that I wasn't used to doing, like everything. I mean, I never realized how in the Bangles there was this great ability to take little breaks, and the fact that everybody sang was really a blessing because everybody's voice got a chance to rest. And it really is, you know, very difficult to sing for hours at a time. It's very hard physically.
By the end of 1991, 2 years after the split, Susanna felt lost and isolated without her former bandmates.
Very soon after, I had regrets about it, and I started to kind of try to figure out a way to, for all of us to start thinking about really being a band again.
Susanna, of course, was, you know, there in the background. Hey, let's get together. Let's get back together.
To start with, Debbie and Vicky's reaction was, get lost. I think Vicky's words were, if I quote her right, my medical bills would cost more than any money we make.
If it's going to be the same, I sure don't want to do it. I mean, I've already done this. There's no need to do it again if it's going to be the same.
Like Debbie and Vicky, Michael needed time to heal. She left L.A. for the redwoods of Northern California.
That's been kind of part of the healing. I needed to be in a peaceful place. A place where people have a different kind of mentality about what it is to be a human being.
Michael's own healing had barely begun when in 1993, her father was diagnosed with cancer.
I remember sort of sitting on a couch with a cup of tea for about six years or so. My head went into a very dark place.
After a 5-year struggle, Michael's father lost his battle with cancer. A year later, her mother also passed away.
Since my parents have both died, I have feelings about mortality. You know, I have feelings about feeling very temporary. So it sort of puts this whole rock and roll thing in perspective.
Susanna's perspective on life changed too when she fell in love with aspiring filmmaker Jay Roach.
There was something in his eyes that was so kind. I met the Bangles through an ad in the newspaper, which is essentially a blind date situation. And then I met Jay on a blind date. So I guess you just have to kind of put yourself out there sometimes.
I do remember the night being sort of misty and diffused and romantic, like a black and white movie or something.
It was always kind of a magical slow motion moment for me when I met Jay.
Susanna and Jay married in 1993. Within 5 years, Jay's success as a film director would bring the Bangles back together. Coming up, back to the 60s, Austin Powers spies a Bangles reunion.
We made a fun little pop record.
It actually was fun. Imagine that. Bangles have fun.
When Behind the Music continues.
From the things that line our way.
In 1998, Susanna Hoffs was a happily married mother of two. That same year, Debbie Peterson gave birth to a son. Motherhood gave them a way to reconnect as friends.
And it just brought us together and enabled us to slowly, over time, over years actually, kind of let down our guard, feel comfortable, feel caring feelings for each other. You better
listen. From there on, it went into talking about, what about getting back together? And then I thought, well, it's been a long time, been lots of water under the bridge, you know. Maybe we should try it.
A year later, Susanna's husband, movie director Jay Roach, asked her and Debbie to write a song for the sequel to his hit comedy, Austin Powers. Susanna now had the perfect opportunity to get Vicki Peterson and Michael Steele back on board.
We got in the studio to record it, and it was funny, we were all, because we hadn't rehearsed for 10 years, we hadn't played, we hadn't done anything together, it's the four of us for 10 years.
And Vicki and I were so in sync with each other, and we were finishing each other's sentences, we were having the same instincts about everything.
It was just like, wow, that's them, they're here, it's like they had never been away, and it was very exciting.
It actually was fun, yeah. Imagine that. Bangles have fun. Film at 11.
And the exhilaration of that and the bonding that we felt just pushed it another step further.
That next step was working together on new songs for the first Bangles album in a decade.
When I heard that the girls were going to get back together, I was the least surprised person on earth because it's sort of like a family reunion.
Okay, ready?
Could it be that we're lost at sea and we're drowning under the stars up to me?
Wait, someone's playing the wrong chords. What are those?
This time, the Bangles are determined not to repeat the mistakes of the past.
Now we sit in a room and say, okay, let's get this out in the open, you know. So it's just basically learning from our mistakes and learning just time. I think time just heals all wounds, you know.
We're doing this very carefully, very slowly, and very much our own way, and very much because we just want to do it.
I don't know. I'm really excited. I'm excited to see what's coming.
Give me time to salvage one.
20 years after the Bangles were just four girls in a garage, Vicki, Debbie, Susanna, and Michael have recaptured the spirit that inspired their rock and roll dream.
It's like we've gotten our act together and we're going to take it on the road. It's so great, you know. But I feel that, you know, it's kind of like I feel like wearing a little happy face button or something.
Oh
but
my
it
God.
Does.
Oh, no, don't go that far.
Okay, I won't go that far.